Morning, everyone. I'm happy to have Zvi again, and he's going to continue his talk on the narratives and the perception of time in social networks.
Okay, so thank you for coming. Today we are going to talk, to continue talking about time and higher dimension social network or object. So the first thing that I want to talk is about we continue to scan the book, and this is a chapter 14. It's the tale of two clocks. As I said, any two clocks can tell a story, especially bad clocks, and the story is when they deviate from each other. And then you can interpret the deviation and ask what happens, why one of the clocks changes its speed, or maybe both of them. So the main problem respect to when we want to apply correlation, especially for clocks, is the fact that the correlation of two clocks is always positive, because clocks are continuous. They are monotonic functions. They start at zero, end at one, and the correlation is always positive. And if we look on the definition of the correlation, you can see that if you have two vectors or any two random variables, you compute the expectation, and when you do that, you have to remove the expectation of the random variables, right? So you do the expectation of the random variable, the first random variable minus the expectation of the first random variable, the same for the second. You multiply them inside the correlation. This suggests that if we want to do correlation for clocks or for function in general, it's better to take a to remove the correlation or the you know, the predictable values of the function. And so this is exactly what the M diagram did for us, right? We take the clocks and we remove the standard time or the expectation of the second clock. So you can see there are three theorems. One is saying that the correlation of any two clocks is positive, and the main reason is that those are monotonically increasing function. In fact, it's very easy to come with any value between zero and one. And even if you want to, if you have two clocks, so you know that it, first time it's zero, and the end of the narrative it's one. So the worst case is basically a vector, two vectors, one is zero, and then all of it one, and the second one is zero, and all of it is until the end, and then you get one, and this is approaching zero because they agree only on the first time step and the last time step, so it's approaching zero easily. And now if we take the M diagram of each of those clocks, then you get that the correlation can be general function as you like. So this is so now I want to convince you that the M diagram captured the time when the deviation started, when the clock started. So we can come with a definition of a narrative where we have a single deviation. What does it mean, a single deviation? It means that if you are looking on normal clocks, and there is no reason not to look on them, at some point in the narrative, one of the clocks start to deviate. So it means that you can divide the interval, the unit interval, into two parts. When in the first part, you can, there are, the, If you look only on the first part, it's the same clock. And if you look on the second, only in the second interval, it's the same clock. But if you look on the completely complete interval, they are not the same. So it's like here you can imagine that this was the speed of the first and the second. So maybe one of the clock measured the time in hour and the other in seconds. And this is the speed of the second. It's switch because the integral has to be one. So if one of them, if the blue line is above, then the red, the orange line should be above after the deviation. And now if you integrate, you see that you get these two clocks. And now this is a single drift, right? There is something happened and then one of the clock, or maybe both of them change the speed. So now if you look on the M diagram, if you want to see the M diagram of those two clocks, it's just you take this graph and you rotate it by 45 degrees, because we said that at time zero, the M diagram is zero, at time one, the M diagram is one, zero. So it's basically becoming like that or like that. And you can see that it's really, the extreme point is becoming the time when the deviation appears, so start to happen. So basically the tools, the fact that we take and we normalize the clocks and then do one clock minus the second one, it's measured the distance between them, and the extreme point is where the distance is maximized. So you can see that here the distance is really maximized. Okay. So let's talk a little bit about the connection between prediction and the M diagram. So here you can see, I think it's maybe it's Romeo and Juliet, but I'm not sure. So if you think about what we, so let's say that we are going to the movie and we watch the movie and we want to apply those two clocks. You know, let's say the time from the beginning of the movie and the number of words that the actors speak or can do, whatever, any other clocks. So up to a single point in the time, when we do it online, right, what do we need to do? We need to normalize the clocks. So we need to know how long is the movie and how many words there will be in the total. Once we know that, we can, we know exactly the number of words that we hear up to this point, and the number of, and the time that passed up to that point. So the only thing that we are missing is basically to nail down the end of the narrative. How many bits we use, right? It's not so many. It's and moreover, we can approximate it. So if we know roughly the up to a factor of two the length of the movie, then we can divide by two to the I or something like that and get a quite good estimation. So basically, if you want like a rule of thumb, how many bits we are stealing from the future when we want to apply it online, it's just log n bits, right? Moreover, we have a roughly estimation of how many words there are in a movie and how many time it takes. So you can really, yes.
I don't understand how you can normalize online to ensure that at time one,
because
value one.
Let me, no, so, okay, let me tell you how I normalize. Maybe I will do it in mathematical, this is going to be easy. Okay, so it will be clear, okay? Okay, so this is a mathematical. So let's have two clocks, just a fake two clocks. So let's take a random integer, and let's put a zero and one, and let's have like a 20 numbers. Okay, so this is the first one. Let's call it delta 1. So these are the ticks of the clocks. Now we want to accumulate it, so it would be a clock. Call it a C1. So this is the first clock, and let's make another clock. Let's assume that we can have a, it's a little bit different. So we, now we can have two, zero, one, or two ticks. Maybe we do it like that. One, two, and then this will be because we want to time to tick. So okay, so we do that, and then we do that. So now we have. Oops, what happened? No, I just don't do that. Okay, so now we have two clocks. So let's normalize the first clock, and then we can use the same, and maybe we'll write a function that will do that for us. But if we want to normalize the first clock, we need to force the clock to start at zero. Right? So we need to do the table. We take the first clock at time I, and we need to remove the first clock, the first time, right? Sorry, so it's one, okay? And now we need to divide, we want to make it one, right? So we do C1, the last time.
So exactly that's.
Wait.
How do you do that online?
Wait. C1 A1. Okay, so this is the. I normalize now the y coordinate. So the if I draw it. C1. Okay, so if I want to normalize the x coordinate, it's also easy, right? Let's do that as well. So we need to have a vector, and we do I minus 1 divided by the length. Length of C1. Minus 1. And we need to close this bracket. Okay, so now we have the first normalized clock. Let's just draw it. Yes, David, what did you want to ask? And this is, you can see that this is the monotonic function.
Yeah.
No, go no. From 0 to 1, to 0 to 1. So now, what did I do, right? In order to really normalize it, so if I go to the y coordinate, I need to know the first time, that I need to know C1 at 1 and C1 at the end. That's it.
So
it's log n bits, right?
That you cannot do it online.
No, if I know those two numbers, I can do it online.
Okay.
But I can guess those numbers.
Okay.
So it's in some sense, what I want to say is that it's very few bits. It's log n bits that we steal from the future. It's not like we need everything. We just need very few bits to steal from the future. We still stealing from the future information, but it's not a lot. It's a very few, and you can run simultaneously, let's say log n estimation, and then really get what's going on online. So this is the connection between prediction and narrative, right? It's like when you read, you know, when you have the book, you know how many words you still have, and you know how much time it will take you, so you get a good estimation. Even during watching movie, you know that it will not be 10 hours. If it's a movie, if it's a series, then again, it's infinite time. So it's another story, but you know the length of the chapter. Okay, so that's the connection. And here you can see how this function evolves over time. Right? I normalize all the time, like this is going to be the end, and you see that, let's say, this point is important. So it's at 400, and you can see that now it's not important. But pretty soon it's becoming important, right? So this is online normalization, like the narrative end now. I'm not stealing any bit from the future. Again, it takes some time to the maximum to arrive because I always forced this point to be zero. So even if it's a maximum, I'm pushing it down. And then I think this is a very, very important idea, the fact that we don't try to predict. We in narrative, we try to hold the beginning and the end, and then the narrative is like a snake. Once you catch those two end points, the narrative cannot move too much. It's much more stable than just a prediction, the Brown motion or random process. Okay? Okay. Let's see. Okay, so here there are some questions that we discussed a little bit. Find the critical. So now what it's we said is that the M diagram gives us the critical point, and you can if you press here, I will publish the notebook, so you can go, you get the narrative of the. You get who is speaking, what is said. This is an Excel, so it's very, very easy. And you can use this Excel to any script because you just need to put who is speaking and what they say. And then the formula counts you the number of words by counting the space. It's normalized because I take the... I can go to the last counter and divide it by that. And it even draw the graph. And you can get the extreme point, the minimum and the maximum. So it's just applying Excel. It's not a high mathematics, and students from high school can do it. Right? So just linear function and not even programming. Very, very simple. Let's go back. Okay, so this is a really nice exercise. And it's again, I think it's very interesting to you know, one of the biggest questions we have in philosophy is if we have a free will or not. And we can ask ourselves the same question about a movie or a narrative or a book. Is the book supporting free will or supporting a deterministic point of view? So you can apply very simple algorithm. Really, really just counting the number of question marks. And you, so this will be one clock. The second clock will count the number of exclamation marks. And if you have more question marks, then you have a free will. And if it's less, then you will support deterministic. And just tell you something about if you, for instance, count the number of exclamation mark in Spinoza, the methoda, you see that he doesn't have any question marks at all, maybe three or something like that. And he has many QED, right? So QED is like exclamation mark. You are forced to. It's totally deterministic. And indeed, he really supported the. He thought that the world is deterministic. And if you compare it to Descartes, and Descartes has many, much more like question. And this is funny that the question mark and the exclamation mark really point to their point of view. Of course, you can easily manipulate this silly algorithm, right? You just delete the question mark, or you don't do your work when you put those marks in the text. But the idea is that this is like a very, very simple, you know, you can call it AI, but I don't know, it's just counting argument on a text. And you can ask a very complicated question, right? You cannot imagine that, well, now maybe ChatGPT can answer the question if Spinoza supports free will or not, I don't know. But this is a very, very simple algorithm without any knowledge about anything, about what we ask. The fact is that it stands on the shoulder of the people that put the exclamation mark and the question mark. They have a deep understanding of, right? So this is the, and if you do it on the Matrix, I don't know if you saw it or not, this is a really nice movie. So the it's about the apocalyptic movie, and it's really at some point Neo is forced to become the one. That's the it's really interesting. So he has some kind of a teacher, which his name is Morpheus, and the machine kidnap him. So he want to save him, and he's actually forced. And you can really see it when you do the clocks of the exclamation mark and the question mark. Another question is, how do you prove that this thing is spoken? This is really a huge question, because we saw that if you have a single deviation, then the M diagram find it, and you can see that when the narrative has a single important point, for instance, in Julia and Romeo, there is the point when Romeo killed Morfalio. So this is the, all the people agree that this point, up to that point, the play is, you know, a comedy. And now it's becoming a tragedy because he is forced to escape, and they don't have any chance to fulfill their life of love, right? And then you can apply it to those clocks, and you see that basically, you know, it's not exactly, but it's a point to that point, or you can do it for any of those narrative that all the people agree. But the fact is that we don't want to agree, we want to argue, and then this is a big question. It's not really that you can prove that something is, it's the same as in physics, right? This is it's a metaphysics claim, and not really, it's about psychology and the way we write it. And as we talked yesterday with David, there could be a great author that knows those rules and say, well, now I want to show that this rules doesn't work, and maybe he will write the next Ulysses. But this is, in some sense, I believe, the statistics of now. Okay, so now I want to talk a little bit about it's like category theory, it's general nonsense, but you need to do to organize things in mathematics so that it will be clear, and it's a very powerful tool, what I'm going to present, because it generalized what we did yesterday, and it make you wondering what is a social network, right? It's not clear. We all think about social network or dynamic social network as function from time to let's say metric space or graph space. But in fact, you could, if you think about narrative, time is a multi-dimension object, and I will explain and give you an example where it's two-dimensional very pretty soon. So here is the diagram, and you can see that I'm really using a lot of the category theory in a very shallow ways, right? I'm not using any theorem, but I'm using the diagram because I think this is the language you want to define some stuff. It really makes sense to use this. So we said that a narrative in some sense is evolving social network. So we go from function to graph or matrices. Now we can take any, if we have a matrix, we can go and project it to the real number, right? It's very easy. For instance, you can look on the IIJ, A, if the matrix is A or gamma, gamma time T, IJ, right? Or the sum of the row or the sum of the column. The sum of the row is the degree, right? So you could imagine that I have a graph and I'm interested in a single person. I can look on the degree or the page rank or any other function or the coloring or the Indian values of the matrix or any other function that I'm interested in. If I take a matrix and I project it to a real number, it's a simplifier and it's easier to study a number or a function than to study evolving social network because there are many numbers. So this is a simple, and now we can, since we are talking about function, we can compose functions. So for instance, in the last week, I put an exam and I asked them, the student to compute when the expansion of the narrative is, you expand the graph of the narrative as much, it's when it's maximized, when the narrative maximizes the expansion. Right, so you take the matrix, you take the Ingen values, since the matrix, the adjacency matrix is a or weighted adjacency matrix, it's a positive and zero, so the biggest Ingen values is positive. So if you sum those numbers, it's one, you can normalize it, you can take the M of that function, and then you can see when the expansion of the characters and the triangles in the narrative is maximized. And this is give you the point when you basically the network of the narrative grow as much as possible. Again, so we start with a narrative. A narrative is a function from time to metric space. We have a single function that take any matrix and compose it. So for instance, this is the maximal Ingen values of the multi-adjacency matrix, and then you basically can manipulate whatever we did before, right? So it's general things to do, and the reason why it's interesting is because we know very well this function, this object. We know we learn it. We have calculus. We have we can integrate. We can take derivative. It's a well-known object, and we have a powerful tools to study. So again, we can normalize any function, right? The idea is that you start from a time, you go to a metric space or a graph space, you have a function that go back to R. Now you can normalize it. And notice that when we normalize clocks, it was 0, 1, go to 0, 1. Now it's 0, 1, go to R. Because what is important for me is that at the end of the narrative, it will be 1. Because I want to nail those, and then I will do that function minus that function. So I want to nail the end and the beginning of the narrative. So now it's R because maybe in the middle, it will go below or above. Above or below 1 or 0. because now it's not monotonic function, so it could be going up and then going down, so general function. But the thing is that it's not clear. Usually we would like to go from 0,1 to 0,1, but now it's not the essence of the thing. The essence of the tools is to take care of what's going on at time zero and what's going on at time one, because you want to nail down the beginning of the narrative and the end of the narrative. You want to say, I know what's going on, I know how the narrative ends. It's not about prediction. So I'm paying by not knowing the range or the image of the function, but I know the end of the story. So this is much more important, and things behave better like that. Okay, so and again, you can normalize, you can define the M diagram of a function. It's just the function normalized minus the standard time. And then you can compute the correlation and things behave much better. The correlation works much better if you do that like that than just correlation on the function without removing the expectation. It's not surprising, right? That's what they teach us in first or second year of the university, right? They say you need to remove the expectation when you do correlation. But the thing is that in our case, when in narrative, the function moves through time with a single function, and the correlation, the expectation, if we know the beginning, we know the end, we know the interval, then it's T, right? So you need to remove T and not the, so that's the reason. And in fact, this is really, suddenly correlation works in our theory, it's a network, and you can really ask a complex question like, who Michael don't like? How would you do that? You look, or you take the degree centrality function of Michael, it's the way is important in the network is, grows, just you look on the social network of the narrative, who spoke after whom, you take the degree of Michael, you remove the, you normalize this function, and then you remove the time, a T, and now you do it for all the characters, and now you can do correlation. And this is, so here this is, you do the degree, so you take the evolving function, the degree function become a function of time, right? Because the graph change over time, and this is a function from the time of the movie to the natural number. Now you can normalize this function, and then so this is an example of so this is an example. So this is a degree centrality. Degree centrality is different than degree, but you need to divide by the total number of edges. So basically you divide by time. Because each round another edge arrives. So you can see this is the first scene with in Macbeth with the witches. You have the first witch, the second one, the third one, and you can see how it's going. You see that here it's a you divide by two by time, so it's like a 1/T, so it's curved, and this is the degree centrality, and this is the M diagram. And now it's very, very nice to see that if you look on those this graph, you see that the first, this is the first, the second, and the third. And you can see that the second prefer the first points. And now if you look on the text of Macbeth, you see really that they don't like each other. They have a complex relationship, the witches they appear twice, and you really see, you know, I think all the, it's very, very delicate feature to try to see what is the relationship between the three witches, right? They appear twice or three times in the play, and you need to really go, it's a very small resolution. But the fact that is, that since we use machine, we can probe the narrative in much higher resolution. We count words, we can do much, much more delicate analysis than standard literature. So for me, it was really nice to see that suddenly, you know, when you think about the three witches, there are the three witches and there is no relationship between them, but in fact, they don't like each other, or some of them like each other more than the other or something. Because usually they speak in rounds. So the first one, the second one, the third one, the first one, the second one. So it's generate a complex relationship, but in fact, the text is also supporting this relationship. Just an example.
So if they speak in rounds and your graph is who speak after who?
Yeah.
Like the definition of your graph?
Yeah, so I think I use the directed graph in this case. So it's really... What was the question?
That the definition of the graph and the definition of how they speak, maybe the order in which they speak is not important for the...
No, but it is. It is important. Especially if you apply correlation, because...
But there's a huge bias in the definition of your graph. Of how you make the graph,
yes,
is really super important.
Yeah, I agree. This is a, I think it's a, who spoke after whom. It's important part of the work. But I hope that someone will come with other graphs that are better, or I don't know, better for something else. I don't know. But I agree that it's a, yeah, it's a game.
So here, what changed compared to what we were talking about yesterday? So because you said that now we have functions that can go above one and
yeah,
below zero.
Yeah, exactly. So yesterday it was closed. So there were monotonics and here they are no longer monotonic. It's general techniques. You can do you go from time to complex object that describe relationship between pairs of humans. And now you project again to the real, so you have this function which is very convenient for you to study, because you can do whatever you want to do with them, because they are simple objects, and we used to do that, right? So working with the matrices, it's a little bit complex. So the thing is that now you have a general technique to go back to what you really know.
So here what you use is this degree centrality.
Yeah, degree centrality. So I think here it's like I divide by time, really, because that's why it's curving. And here it's the M diagram of that. So you can see that the function goes down. They are not clocks. If you will do only degree and not divide by T, then there will be clocks. So because it's only go up, right? Because I don't allow to delete edges. And here is the correlation between those functions. So here is the correlation between the M, and here is the correlation between the degree, and here is between the centrality. And this is really great. When I did that, you know, it's like asking who don't like each other, who like each other. And you can see that, for instance, Macbeth and Lady Macbeth like each other very much. So I want to say something about that. Let's say that we are in the same scene and we talk to each other. So if I'm looking on the indirect graph, then when I'm talking and you respond, and then again, then my degree always go up, because it's who talk after whom. So at some point I'm the head, at some point I'm the tail. So it's the degree of both of us go together. So it's a generate correlation. But if we, let's say that we are an enemy, so usually what's going on is that the good guys get to introduce, and then the bad guy get to introduce, and they introduce in separate times. So it means that their function will not be correlated, because when one of the guys go up, the other doesn't appear. And when this guy appears, then maybe this going down, right? Because either because of the M diagram, his function doesn't increase. So if we do the M diagram, it's going down because you remove T, right? So it's going down. So you generate, you use space, you use time to generate a negative correlation. So if we don't talk to, if we tend to talk to each other, like let's say I'm Sherlock Holmes and Watson, they always talk to each other. So they will have a positive correlation. And if you take him, you know, Sherlock Holmes and his nemesis, what's his name?
Moriarty,
thank you. They, at least at some part of the narrative, they will be separate because we will be introduced to Moriarty, we'll see his plan, he will commit the murder. At some point they will speak, right, at the end of the... So here, but here, this is a Macbeth, and you know there was there is Lady Macbeth, and there is Macduff and Lady Macbeth. So I don't know if you know the story, but basically, Lady Macbeth and Macbeth had a child, and he died, and I think this is the central theme in the play. And then they conspiracy to kill the king. Macbeth kill him, and then Macduff escape from, don't remember where it is, but maybe it's in England. And then Macbeth killed his wife, the lady Macduff. He sent people to kill them and her child. And eventually Macduff kills Macbeth. This is like a very short introduction for the correlation. But now, you know, I knew the story. I never thought about the relationship between Macduff and Lady Macduff. And then I did a correlation. You see, if I do just the degree, it's not so bad. here, not so bad. If you do the M, it's not so good, no? And if you do the M of, I think it's, I don't see what it's, it's the degree centrality. Now it's become very, very negative. And now you say, you ask yourself, oh, wait, actually, he was not really okay, Macduff, right? If you escape from the country because you think that someone is going to kill you, at least you better send some people to warn your wife and your kids, right? The better if you take them with you, right? What do you think will happen to them? Why you escape and not trying to save them? And you see that actually he was not okay. He was, at least compared to his family, he is responsible. And I thought this is a really great example of showing that the mask can point to something interesting. And again, Macduff and Lady Macbeth, for instance, they are good friends. Yeah, they are really good friends. This is an example of Godfather. I think we talked about it yesterday. So I asked the machine, please take the six important people and do the correlation. I did the M diagram of the degree centrality. So I divide by T. And then suddenly I saw that Michael don't like money. And then suddenly I saw the movie differently. So again, you can see that it's a dialogue between machine and man, right? The computer told me, well, look, they don't like each other. And now you can say, why? Right? Or see, well, yeah, they really don't like each other. He's late to her wedding. It could come at time, at the correct time if he wanted, probably. But you know, when you see it, you don't take a, at least I didn't make it a really important point, but actually it's a very important point. It's the beginning of the movie. Right? But when you see just people dancing, and they said, we are waiting for Michael, and he come with a uniform, right? So maybe it's okay to be late. Okay, so now we move to the next chapter. And this is really, I think, great, great chapter, because it's really talking about, you know, if you remember the last time, at the beginning, I said, when I thought about trying to understand the time and perspective and subjective time, it was not clear to me that there is one dimension of time. Maybe there are many. But the end of the day, I decided there is only one time. And here you can see that actually this is not true in some sense. And this is related to what I said yesterday about Fabula and Suzette. So Suzette is the time we consume the story. You can remember that, like Susie tell you the story. And Fabula is the real time, the time it happens. So we move back and forth, both. So you could define the object, a narrative object, which more than one dimension. You see, this is a great tool. So this is evolving social network. This is the first scene in Macbeth. I pick that scene because it's very short and very few people and very easy to see and imagine. The famous scene. Here, notice that we have four characters and not three, because in the end, it's all. So all of them say something. I don't want to take go into account. And I want to say another thing is that this method is very stable for noise. If I decode 10% of the nodes not correctly, if I throw 10% of edges, nothing happens. So it's very, very at random. It's very, very stable, all those functions. So this is like the M diagram, and you can see 1 up to 10. But here, this is in some sense a two-dimensional object. So here it's the when the story start. And this is the accumulation. What's going on? Wait a minute. No, let's take the definition. So this is the evolving social network. So up to that point, we have a single. So the evolving social network went from R to the metric space, and now we can have so it can go from R to the D to the complex matrix. And here it's a great example. Why should we do that, right? Why should we insert another dimension of the narrative? Every story has a beginning and end. So you could imagine that the first coordinate of time is the beginning of the story, and the second coordinate is the end. So this allowed us to move from a single dimension object to a surface of narrative. So a point in the surface is a sub-story, right? It's at the beginning and end. And of course, you can add more coordinate, because maybe you will have a look on the time when you tell the story or something like that. But at least the beginning and the end are really, really crucial parameters when we tell a story. You know, it's really crucial, because you know, you can ignore, if you don't like an event, you can start the narrative just after it. It's no longer there. Like, for instance, the Aeneas, right? The Aeneas start when they conquer Troy. They don't like that Troy was destroyed. No, they don't tell it. He is escaping. They don't care about how Achilles won or how he was. It's very, very crucial. What fact do you put in them in the knot? And when you start? So this is a really important object, and it could show you very easily all the sub-stories, the real sub-stories. Let me show you. Question about that? So so it could be general, d-dimensional, but in fact, we really have an interest in the case where d equal to beginning and the end of the story. It's clearly important. And this, you now have a machinery to generate many, many stories, like a surface of stories. So time frame is when the story starts and when it ends. So usually I'm using either B or S, B for beginning and S for start. And E is always end. So here is the example I show you. It's here it's when the scene starts, and here it's when it ends. So here it's always empty, right? Because it starts when it's end. What happens if the story starts after it ends, right? You can put, right? So this you can interpret it in both, in two ways. You can interpret it as going back on time, right? Telling the story backwards. You can also put minus just, like since you do integrate or sum, you can, when you change the order of the summation, usually you put minus. That's why I use it. And I think we will use that thing, but you can do it otherwise. You can interpret it differently. So again, let me just remind you, what is a surface? So a surface is a function that takes two numbers and give you three numbers. Let's say, could be four, but it's still a surface. But we like it like that. We like to see it. So this is a torus, this is a ball. So now you can imagine that we can do the same thing because we have a time the narrative start, the time the narrative end, and we go to the metrics that describe all the connection between those, all the characters in the sum all the edges, or maybe it's a information that we can need the machinery to retrieve it. And now if we have a function that go from the metric space or the graph space to the real numbers, we can have a surface, right? Because we have two numbers and we get the third. So this is the surface of substories. It's when it starts, when it ends, we get the matrix and we compose it, we project it to the real number. So now we have a surface of stories. And let's look on the surface. So this is the coordinate when the story ends, start. This is the coordinate when the story ends. What are those points? Nothing. The time it starts equal to the time it's end, it's an empty story. What are those points? Right, so this is, it's the story go backward in time. So let's take care of this part. Of course, this is equivalent, right? Because we just use the minus. So what is this line, for instance? What is this point? Let's say, what is this point?
Of length half?
Yeah, exactly. This is half of the story. So it's like this point is from the beginning to half of the narrative. This is from the half of the narrative to the end of the narrative, and all those stories have equivalent length, right? Of course, I didn't say what is the clock I'm using, but let's say I'm talking.
Doesn't it depends on the normalization?
Yeah. So let's assume that we normalize it, and we can imagine that we really watch in the movie and we do Greenwich time. You can do it for any flows, right? Let's say. And what is this line?
Start at
half.
Yeah, start at half and go up to the end. And so Y axis parallel to Y, it's start at some point and continue to the end. This is end at some point and continue to the end. And I think it's clear. Okay, so now let's put real graphs into the game. So this is the depth of a segment. And you can see, so here I think I switched the coordinates. So this is really the narrative. So, but you can see that you can really see, you can really see that. So, yeah, so Willy, I don't know if you know this story or not. I will tell the story. It's a nice story. It's a play, and there is a movie you can see with by Dustin Hoffman. I think you can see it for free in YouTube. It's from 82, and somehow it's on YouTube. I don't know why, but it is. It's a play, so play a movie, and the story is about it's about an American family. Willie is the father, and it looks like everything is they are like very very nice family, and Willie is a salesman. So he almost not sleep all the time, not sleep. And at some point in the beginning of the play, they decide to fire him. And he thinking of committed suicide. Eventually he will do it. And during the play, you learn that he had an affair. And he has a Beth. Beth was a very successful kid. He almost got into college. He was a football player. And he had a problem with math. He didn't succeed. And the teacher decided to pass him, let him pass. His problems in life is to pass this math exam. He's so happy, he's traveling to Boston to tell his father. If I'm not mistaken, maybe he needed his father help, I don't really remember. He comes to the hotel and he sees that his father sleeping with another woman. And he cannot stand it, he ran away from home. And he saw everything, and he never talked to his father again. Or it's like nothing happened. He don't remember. He didn't get it, but he leave everything and he stopped everything. And Linda, it's the wife. She doesn't understand what happened. And his brother doesn't understand what happened. And in the end, he committed suicide. So you see that the main character is William. Here is the description of the family in the beginning, like it was a happy family. Here is the I think here it's the scene when you discover that Beth know that his father cheating on his mother. So this explains this weird phenomena. This is a story about Linda that she doesn't understand. You see, you can really see all the sub-narrative inside this diagram. It's not exactly accurate because this is a degree centrality. So the main characters start to be important just a little. They need to take to get more important than the other degree than the other. So this is the story that they are zero length, right? And here it's the negative. So this is the people who are not important. So happy is not really important. For instance, all most of the time is not. And this is like the same thing when I cut the scene and I explain what happens in the and this is like just the surface together with degree. Of course, you can, for instance, decide that you are interested in dialogues and you want to see when Willie had a dialogue with Beth. So you just do the sum of the degree, right? So you can pop up. But this is a mechanic. Tools, and it's very nice way to visualize what's going on in the narrative with respect to sub-narrative. So this is the same thing now. This is the narrative here. This is like this is the Godfather. So you can see that Michael is the main hero. This is the story of Sonny, you know when he was assassinated. This is the assassination, I think. This is when they kill the Don Corleone and Sonny. Sorry, this is when Sonny take care. He become the Don, and here he is killed. And this is when Michael. This is Hagen's. So you can see again that you. Can really see here. Probably this is when they killed the when they killed Don Corleone. They tried to kill, and this is exactly when Sonny take the family business. You can see this is a very visual tools, but it has a meaning, and it's really nice and beautiful to see and.
Can I ask a question?
Okay, so again, this is chapter 19. So, okay, sorry, can you repeat the question?
No, the question was whether I can ask a question.
Yes, why not?
So, maybe I'm taking you back a bit, but I'm not sure I understand what the different colors mean.
So this is like the degree centrality of Michael. So if you look on this color is when Michael is the main character because his degree is going above everyone else. So you don't see the other people. Here, for instance, Sonny is the main character. So you don't see Michael because his degree surface going above. So I'm plotting several degrees.
And, no, but okay. But then what is T1? Tau 1 and Tau 2?
Huh? So Tau 1 is when the narrative starts, and Tau 2 is when it ends. So I'm looking, so here, the point is a sub-story.
A
sub-story that started Tau 1 and ended Tau 2, and there are many people in these sub-stories, right? But there is only one person that speaks the most. This one you will see. This one will determine the color.
No, but then a point in this chart is an interval of time between T1 and T2.
Yeah, it's a sub story. It's an interval of time. The narrative that started.
I see. So every point is a narrative of time. Is an
interval of time.
Interval of time, and the color says something about the degree centrality. Who has the highest degree centrality in this interval?
Exactly. Okay. So I'm calling it time interval, time frame of the narrative. It's as you said, an interval. And the color is determined according to the degree central, the max degree central in that narrative.
Okay.
Why isn't it symmetric? I don't understand what's.
So this is the those are the narrative that start and end at the same time.
Yes. So it's
this is
zero.
Time narrative that go back on time. Going back on time, you put minus. So actually, those are the less important guys. They are the one that don't appear. And of course, it's also related to the order I plot here, the function, because most of them will be zero. They don't appear. So it's the last guy or the first guy, I don't remember. There are many people that are not important. There is only one person that is important in something like it. Okay. Thank you, Adi.
One more question.
Yeah.
So what's the difference between the degree and the degree centrality?
So the degree is just a degree.
Yes.
You sum up all the number of it's the number
of
go out or in a node. Degree centrality you divide it by the time or by the number of edges.
So it's the kind of the frequency, something like the frequency of
the average frequency. If you
yeah.
Because
okay.
Every time an edge arrives, right? So it's the total number of edges is equivalent to the time.
Okay.
Okay. So now I want to define the point of view. I already mentioned that. So basically, so this is a graphic point of view. So you start a subset of edges, and the total number of time the edges in SE arrive to the link stream. So you look on a subset of edges, and now you can count how many time, and so this is. And now you can get a sub story of those edges, right? Just when they speak. So so this is chapter 19, and then you can get a sublinks stream. It's just when you look on the link stream. So it's a and of course you can define it using the first condition. And now you can have a dialogue point of view, for instance, is just when two people talks. And if you do the direct graph, then it's break into two when I talk to you and when you talk to me. So you have like three point of views, right? One is the indirect and the other one is the direct for both sides. But those things you can learn, what I think about you, what you think about me, and what we think together. And this is like what is it you can do the M diagram or try to see what is important to each of the main characters, for instance, in the narrative. And here you can see this is Michael. What is important to Michael? This is before his father is assassinated. He's thinking he's going to study and become a senator. This is his dream, his father's dream. And here is when he becomes the Don. He accepts his fate that he didn't work. He has to take care of the family and business. So he's a man has to choose what he will do. Will believe. I believe that he has to choose, and he chose to save the family. This I think it's the Don. I want other things for you, son. He tell him this is he wants him to be a senator. And here he decides that he will be a Don. And this one, I don't remember what is it. Okay, but you see that the fact that it's not only working for the narrative, but it's working also for the character, you know, you shrink the data by a factor, right? It's a sub story which is less part of the story. It's a little bit convincing that the method is really say something about the psychology or the way we construct narrative. I don't know. Yeah.
So here the graph represents something like how many times, for example, in the first one, does Michael talk to Don?
Yeah. Exactly. So this is like it's even more shrinking it, zoom in. It's only about the connection to between them, right? So it's you're right. So this is what Michael says. This is what Don, and this is what they say to each other. So this is the indirect. This is the direct. You see, we did a zoom. We use the same tools for the complete narrative. We zoom to a character, and now we zoom to a dialogue between two characters. So it's like three level of zooming, and still you get that at least in this example, it captures very nice what the character thinks and what is important to them, and so on. So this, for me, it was very important to see that it's stable, even if I do zooming, because at some point, you know, things break down when you do zooming. So for instance, you have a statistical mechanics, and when you do zoom, eventually you will see a single atom and it will not work. Right? At some point, always tools break down, right? So you could zoom to a single edge. So this is a egocentric point of view. What people talk about you, and again, you can have three point of view. You can have the direct and indirect, and take any direction. And again, it's really nice. You can see that. People think that Michael is suitable for becoming a Don, and so on. Let's continue. And this is a gossip when I remove the guy that remove all the just the neighborhood, and again you can see. Yeah, I think that's the end of what I wanted to. So we define the, in conclusion, we define the narrative is from mechanics, show. We talked about, let me conclude what we did in the last 2 days. So we talked about link stream and evolving social networks. We talked about objective and subjective time. Perspective and retrospective time and the holiday paradox, if you remember, and the formula to move from one another. And we talked about how we compare clocks, and we came up with this M diagram, which is basically saying that if you want to study functions of a narrative of an evolving graph, you should remove the expectation. Like what we do in correlation, we should do it the same in when we study evolving social networks. So the degree is not so good. You better remove the expected degree from the signal if you are interested in the narrative. We show how to do correlation. Again, it's the same idea. And so the message is that if you do want to use correlation over social network, at least in a narrative sense, you want to take to remove the expectation or the signal or the prediction, because it's not, we don't care about the prediction, we care about the interpretation. So we remove the prediction. We saw a general technique to transform from a narrative or evolving social network to real function, and then again, how to apply it. We saw that we talked about the substory surface and how you can zoom into substories and apply the same techniques and get a still meaningful interpretation or Yeah, that's it, I think.
Well, I have a question. Again, it's going, taking you back. Vika?
So to get some questions, sometimes I was thinking about it. So when you said that the clocks are always monotone, so you said that the clocks are always monotone, like that.
Yeah.
I was thinking about these movies when they go back in time and they relive their life again, or that they
Momentum. Or...
If then at the example you look at the like the fabula time and the storyteller time, then they are not monotonic, right? Like one goes back.
So the fabula is not. I'm talking, at least in the book, I'm talking, in my imagination, I'm thinking about the way you consume the narrative. So although in Momentum or the other movies that they do that, you go back in time, the way you construct the narrative, it's through time. So you consume the narrative. I imagine, this is how I imagine it. It's like a retrospective time. The story already happened. You know it happened because people 2 hours ago watched the same movie. So it's all, and you see, someone tells you the story, construct the narrative in your head. And that's for me the time. But of course, what you said is really, and this is great because then you can get much more complicated surface of narrative, and it's a great area of research. But you know, we have to start somewhere. So that's
So basically, what we were looking at here is like we don't consider the fabula time.
No. I'm really doing Sozetta. Exactly. No, I don't. Although, you know, I play a little bit, but it's not exactly. I play a little bit by moving from the retrospective to prospective time when I, for instance, study Hitchcock. And it was really useful, at least for Hitchcock, because it really, some part of the movie is in real time. So any part that you really, you know, the movie is in real time, it's not a retrospective, it's perspective. So it's you need to convert and use those formula to move from one to another.
So it's again going back. Can you again define this M? What was it? M? Go back one slide.
This one?
Yeah. So can you precisely define again the M diagram that came back in the talks quite often?
Yeah. So it's very simple. So you have two functions. Let's start with the clock, and then I will extend it to general function. You have two clocks, so you need to normalize them because you need to compare. You don't want to that one of the clocks will work with a hour and the other one with milliseconds. You don't. It doesn't make sense. So you normalize it, and the way you normalize it is that a single unit is the complete narrative. So a clock starts at zero because the narrative starts at zero. And end at one.
Okay.
So this is the way you normalize it, and you allow to normalize only by linear function, and you normalize the x coordinate and the y coordinate. So it's a decomposition of L2 C L1. This is the L1 is talking about the x coordinate, and L2 is talking about the y coordinate. Okay, so L1 and L2 are linear function. And this is basically canceling the Euclidean symmetry of that clock says. So now I do that for the two clocks. So I force the clocks to measure the time in narrative units. And then I do one minus the other. What does it mean, one minus the other? So nc1 of t minus nc2 of t. It's basically I remove the expectation of, so I said, let's say nc1 t is the real, is the clock that I'm interested in. I need to remove the expectation of the time. And I do that using L2, NC2 clock. So it's basically trying to say, if they were really synchronized, then and nothing happened, then it should be zero, right? But they are not synchronized. Therefore, I'm interested in when they stop being synchronized. So basically, it's the maximum of that function.
Okay.
Now, if you want to do it for any function, not just monotonic, what is really important is the m of a function at zero will be zero, and at m of two functions at one should be zero again. The object is to get a Brown bridge, or to nail down the narrative from the beginning and to end. You know that Moses will succeed and will take the Hebrew people to the promised land. You know that. It's not about predicting if Moses will succeed or not. No, it's the way, it's about interpreting your life and if you will be coming a free man and who will try to stop you reaching the promised land. That's the essence. So we don't care about the end because we know it. And so, when you normalize general function, you force the function to be at 0, 0, and at 1, 1, because once you subtract two function, then you will get 0 at 0 and 0 at 1. So you will be able to hold the narrative from both point of view. You will be able to control it much better and understand what's going on better. That's the key. So now, when you do it for general function, you lose the normalization. It's not a function that goes from 0, 1 to 0, 1. It's a function that goes from 0, 1 to R. And when you normalize it, the important thing is that at the end of the narrative, it will be 1. Because this is the way you say, I know the end of the narrative. It's 1. Okay, you want to see
more or less
the formula, or it's okay?
No, I think more or less I get it. I think I got the general idea. We can discuss later if I have more questions.
Questions, and thank you.
Thank you very much.